Good morning, guys. Welcome to another edition of Kafka Meetup at Bangalore. This time it's at near office in Koramangala. The previous one was in Walmart Labs, and I asked how many of you actually attended the previous edition. This one we have four sessions, all the way till 3 o'clock, starting with Near and then Confluent, Make My Trip, and then the last one with Gojek one, right? And I'm hopeful that by the end of these four sessions, you get some meaningful output from it. I'm not expecting you guys to be master of Kafka if you're not one, right? It's all about, if I go to sessions like this, my goal is actually if I can grab one or two things from each session and then see whether you as an engineer or senior engineer can actually correct or apply in your new things, right? We would be doing the same thing for the remaining three sessions as well, to see what we could have learned or what we could have applied better, in our company as well, from our others' learnings. With that said, this is going to be on the fourth floor, all the speakers. The second floor is the overflow. So that means like if in case if we go more than the seats allocated, our guys will move first to the second floor so you guys can continue attend live from here, right? And we'll take it from there. Cool. So our first session is on the Near Big Data platform. We call it as Nautilus. But before that, I'll just introduce myself. I'm Mahesh. Mahesh Vandichalil. It's my second year, 2 years completed in India. I moved from US after a couple of decades over there. So I'm pretty old, unlike the physics. I was with Apple, Bank of America, Deloitte Consulting in US. And in India, I tried a couple of stints before I joined with Near. I tried as a VP of engineering in Hotstar. Had so much fun, actually, hitting the world record of 10.3 million concurrency in IPL 10, I believe, IPL 10 or 11. That was 2018. And then I tried my another stint at Nissan as a VP of engineering in Trivandrum, scaling an organization from like 0 to 400. And then after 8 months, I decided this is not what I want, right? And keep looking for it. And I was planning to go back to US to join back with Apple. Finally found the right place, which is Near, dealing with extremely high scale and fantastic engineering team around, surrounded by the good, smart business people. I didn't have to think twice. It's all start from the leadership. And I have my partner here, Suraj. He's a veteran, actually, in Near, but pretty young guy compared to myself. He's the platform architect, platform head, whatever you want to call him as, right? But extremely genius guy who is going to cover in-depth details. And we have all our smart engineers as well behind. So during the break or something, if you want to know more about it, because you're not here to actually know more about Near. You're here to actually grab the nuances of Kafka from all the learnings, right? So we'll not be doing any marketing on Near for sure, right? So let me just understand the people first, right? I mean, there's no point in actually just straight away going to the topic and start delivering the content without understanding who you guys are. So how many of you are new to distributed systems or any kind of distributed systems? Amazing, and that's scary for me actually, because I think there's the nuances of the aspect that people believe that if I'm part of a distributed system, that's something extremely fantastic and awesome. And that means that you guys don't want to go home at 5 o'clock, right? Because there is a simple principle which I learned in 23 years, which is KISS. Keep it simple, stupid, right? Really, guys, I mean, the more complex you design, the more complex the work-life balance becomes, right? So it's not all about, I have been actually part of a distributed system, and, it's all about thousands and thousands of server scales and whatnot. But at the end of the day, it's all about designing to the need which will actually meet the customer's pain, right? So you as an young engineer, I think many of you guys are pretty young engineers, I can see from the outlook, your goal should be to keep it simple. The more you keep it simple, the best the design is going to be, right? And you can keep doing better things, okay? So I'm glad that all of you are distributed system experts, which is going to make the conversations much more easier. And how many of them are actually new to data processing at scale? Any kind of, I mean, let's say a few terabytes a day. You are pretty new. Everyone else is good. Don't be shy, guys. I mean, I dealt with the first biggest scale all the way in 2010. I started in 97, right? The biggest scale I experienced was at 2010 with Bank of America to begin with. Right? Till then, it was a medium scale. You know, so it doesn't mean that if you're not processing data at, you know, scale, or any system you're not processing at scale, means that you're not the best engineer or the smartest engineer. Because the fundamental principle of scale is you design the very first component, right? And for example, you know, when I was with the Hotstar, we used to take pride in you know, meeting the extreme high scale, right? But on the other side of the fence, AWS team and Akamai team will say, hey, we'll also share the big credit because we are the one providing you the cloud infrastructure and the content delivery network. So it's together, right? So what it means is, like, if you design your system correctly, scaling at big is not a big deal. But the complexity becomes a little bit more higher when you're actually dealing with data. A stateless, you know, system when you build, that's much easier for actually to, let's say you are building a web application, right? And you are successfully running all the session management, shopping carts, and all the stuff which you want properly in a couple of servers. And if it works in two servers, you know that your system is now capable of scaling to the third and the fourth and the thousands. Why? Because if one of the users going to the first server, going to the second server, and when the first server is down, means that the user is successfully ported over to the second one, and he's actually experiencing a seamless thing. How did that happen? It's not the underlying infrastructure making it happen, is it? Or is it the developer? Is the developer or the underlying infrastructure making the seamless transition to the second server happen? It could be both. Yeah, because you as a developer making sure that from first server, you can port it to the second when the first goes down. And the infrastructure will make sure that you are routed to the second based on the health check pings and whatnot coming from the load balancer and stuff, right? So that is how you as a developer always from the very first line you write and design, think, what is it actually designed for? And at the same time, don't make it over complex. That means if you know that for next 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, it's going to be just used by 10 users, what you won't do? You won't design for? Scale, right? That is the key. So select the solutions for what is really needed, right? And if you want to learn, I always follow the policy of go home and learn, right? Because at work, you keep it extremely simple, and you learn outside, and then you keep applying, right? Cool. How many of you are new to messaging systems? Pretty decent. Count actually are aware of messaging systems, right? Now goes to a question, how many of you are new to Kafka versus other messaging systems? Okay. So remaining are all familiar with Kafka as a messaging system. That's pretty good, actually. So because otherwise, I would be ending up spending a lot of time defining what is Kafka and messaging system. But let's take a couple of minutes, guys, because I still believe there will be some shy in the group to say who knows Kafka and who doesn't know Kafka. So it's unfair actually to those, you know, who are feeling that shyness, right? So as you know, I'm pretty old. That means like I have gone through the messaging systems for the last decades, right? Couple of decades. So when I started with, it was all, for example, 96, 97 timeframe, it was all mainframe systems, right? All we had to do was like send to the Kix, you know, and the DB2 databases through the COBOL program, get the output back, right? And then comes, so there is a transaction cards in, you know, Kix. But that actually taught me a lot about the data and the data management, how the criticality of the data is, which is called as the acid nature of the data, right? The consistency and the integrity which we need to maintain while dealing with the data, because we are dealing with the, you know, people's data in it, you know, whether it is bank or, you know, insurance systems or anything, right? So from there, actually, you know, 97, 98, when I started with Java, it was all, you know, maximum you do is HTTP calls you make and then get the, you know, response back. Cool. So basically what I was saying was, like, in the beginning world, right, system being small, you know, the scaling being small, I mean, everything was easy for us. Right? As an engineer, all I have to know was the system well, the APIs well, underlying, you know, data well, right? And if we are dealing with petabytes of data right now itself. During the early days itself, people had the mainframe systems dealing with that scale of data, right? But it had its own problem being a single, you know, big servers. So mainframe topics are for another day, right? And then came 2000, 2003s, and 2004s. There as well, you know, when we started designing the systems, right, there came the need for an asynchronous messaging. I mean, it's not just about the request reply. I send something and I get something back. I can wait till I get the response back. There came the need for, you know what, I need to actually post it somewhere so that somebody else can actually process it and then deal with it. And maybe I'll just go and check the status of whatever the process in a polling fashion or whatnot. Now come the, you know, push notifications and stuff where I don't have to poll. Somebody else will actually push for me, right? So basically what it means is that all these requirements started coming as and when we go through the system, as and when we go through the designs, as and when we go through the pain points of customers. Remember, we didn't actually design all this. You know, when I was with Starwood Hotels or, you know, WellPoint Healthcare or Deloitte Consulting or anything, none of us actually designed any system because we want to actually use this XYZ technology. It was purely driven by what the pain point customers are going. And you go behind that. There came in 2003 timeframe, the enterprise EJBs. You know, 2001 onwards, it was kind of like, you know, if you attend the interviews in the US, it was all about, you know, the EJB, stateless session EJB, stateful session EJB, what is entity beans. You deal with the data as entities, right? And there comes the pain point of all the entity beans. And, you know, I mean, you won't believe the kind of amount of effort we actually spend on transaction management because we deal with integrity of data. It was not at all easy. You have all kind of distributed transactions to manage. I think you're aware of that word, distributed transaction, right? Because if it is going to one database, it's so easy for me to manage. For example, if you're dealing with Oracle, right? You create a transaction boundary with Oracle. Very simple. Begin the transaction, commit the transaction, or roll back the transaction. What if I have Oracle to deal with on one side? I have DB2 to deal with on another side. I need to send a messaging system on the other side. That becomes a global transactions. For example, your travel system, right? Make my trip. You go and make, you know, flight reservation, hotel reservations, and whatnot. And if not all of them goes well, you may not want to actually commit the entire transaction. That becomes much more difficult because they are all HTTP driven, you know, lookup against different systems. So when we were using the database driver managers and the connection pools and whatnot, the system was much more easier. There comes a 2010 timeframe where now we are dealing with all distributed transactions in terms of the HTTP calls, where the world became a little bit more complex, right? Now came all this, you know, I don't know whether when am I going to get the call back, right? We started using MQ series. If you are familiar with all the banking, anybody from bank here? Morgan Stanley, anybody from Wells Fargo? You know the, what I'm talking about, right? I mean, you have the traditional databases and the mainframe systems and the DB2s and the Oracle at high scale, and where the number one thing is the integrity of the data, right? My 7-8 years was with State Street Bank and Bank of America. It's all about the integrity of the data we cannot actually compromise with. So that is why where we actually select the technologies when it is really matured enough, because we cannot take a chance with the customer's data or the problem in our hand, right? So now what happens is, like, you know, all the financial institutions, for example, were very solid with IBM MQ series. It did the purpose. You know, I mean, it had everything what I needed at that particular time. I can send a message, right? If I'm actually sending directly to you something, I'll just define a queue, and you'll take the message, you'll process it. But the problem was, like, as a queue, the scaling was easier. I can actually create more consumers, they will continue to take the messages out of the queue, but just trying to one at a time. Now there came the need for broadcasting. Somebody, a postman actually delivering a, you know, newspapers, right? the news articles and the ad marketing stuff, if they are delivering to 100 people, and what 100 people does with each of the same newspaper is different. And that is the concept of the publish subscribe in a topic aspect, where you actually broadcast something to a topic where hundreds of customers can actually, you know, take it and then deal with it, right? So this is the traditional enterprise systems where we faced a lot of problems. What are the problems we faced? I mean, the ordering was a big issue for us. And then we used to actually manage those things in the header of the messages, and you know, we actually post something in between into the database and then go and read it, and all kind of messaging we have to do because underlying messaging systems used to not handle it. Whether it was MQ series, whether it was ActiveMQ, whether it was RabbitMQ, whether it was you know, the WebLogic's you know, JMS system, but they all used to handle it. But the problem was, like, it used to require custom coding from our side as well to handle that aspect, right? So there was one single messaging system which actually missed that aspect of everything which is required. Everything which is required, there comes the need for an Kafka messaging platform. Okay, we'll actually cover more into that. So the way we are gonna, you know, pause this is in the next 30 minutes. We'll actually talk line about near, you know, because the reason that when Suraj is gonna talk about the Nautilus platform in detail, right, understanding that particular aspect is a little bit required. And what products are we currently supporting, and our Nautilus overall architecture, and what are the lessons we learned? Only a few, because we want you to be full energy for the remaining sessions as well. But we are gonna be here if you guys have to ask any questions in detail as well. So NEAR is the world's largest location intelligence platform, you know, we claim it as, for dealing with the people and places. So that means, you know, since last 7 years or 8 years, our journey has been from a startup to the next level. We just completed the Series 4 funding as well. We called us the, you know, because I'm as an SVP of engineering right here means co-parenting the baby. The baby is actually done. And now my responsibility is to take the baby to the adult level or young age, right? So it's all about dealing with, you know, the next level of scale and making sure that the solutions can scale to the level it needs. So major, our entire development center is placed out in Bangalore itself, and the remainings are all sales office and marketing offices. And it's just a, you know, quick snapshot summary of it. You know, we deal with around 1.6 billions of users in our entire system. It's not the e-commerce way of saying the users. It's basically the data which we deal with are connected to 1.6 billion users or their device IDs and stuff. We are across 44 countries and you know, dealing with, because it's all about the people and places, connecting people to the places and the behavior aspect of it. That means we need to have the places data in our system. We have around 70 plus million. Is that correct, Ashwin, still? Okay, so we still have the 70 plus million you know, places data, the point of interest. You guys are familiar with the point of interest through the Google Maps and stuff nowadays, right? So we deal with all those things so that, you know, we can connect all these aspects together to find the right set of insights. That means that would actually enable our customers to do the right set of ad targeting and marketing targeting and whatnot, right? Because at the end of the day, it's a data. So all what we do is we look at the data and actually ask the questions against the data to see what are the problems can we solve? What are the pain points of the users we can actually solve so that we can stay alive in this market? Does that make sense? It's not the other way. Okay, because I always believe in one thing, which is what data you have, based on that data, you solve the problem. So that is why the analysis team and stuff is extremely important, because that's the team gonna be keep on looking at the data and see what are the value does this data provides. So if you can actually ask the right questions against the data which you have, you'll solve the right problems. And if you're actually thinking that you can solve every problem under the sky, with the data which you have, then you will end up with wrong set of problem solving. Okay, and in the current market where the pace is extremely high, it's all about who solves the problem which is really required for the customers and keep moving on, right? Because it may not be relevant in 3 months, 6 months time frame. So we have a couple of major products. AllSpark is our bread and butter, supported by Carbon. So it covers two different aspects of the problem. AllSpark is driven by the audience curation, we call it as, driven by the places. And what Carbon does is at the customer level, go deeper. Okay. Again, you know, the website is the best place to go and learn about it. And you know, all the guys are here. I'm not going to market both of the products to you at the moment. But as an engineering team right here, all of you guys, what's important for you is the Neve and the Nautilus. Neve is our complete engineering platform, near engineering excellence vault. We provide all underlying platform foundation required to build our systems on top, right? So these are all built within last few months. And the Nautilus is the complete data platform, which is covering all the pipelines and stuff, which Suraj is going to talk about. Okay. Now, I'm not going to go through the slide as well, because we already spent a lot of time talking about where does the need for Kafka came, right? Kafka as a messaging system is actually required to cover multiple aspects. As in a traditional enterprise system, it covers the messaging system pretty well. You have underlying HDFS or whatever the storage which you have taken care of the storage aspects pretty well, right? And you have the custom programming, whatever you write, can actually take care of the ordering aspects pretty well. And you actually scale your, you know, messaging system or whatever the way you want to provide the redundancy required pretty well. All these aspects were actually in multiple different systems compared to Kafka, which actually kind of provide us complete fault tolerant, extremely scalable. You can do ETLs, you can do stream processing, you can do simple messaging, right? It actually combined the concept of queue and the topic together, because queue was scalable, right? Topic wasn't. So what they do is, now with a single concept called the Kafka topic, they combined the scalability aspect pretty well. You can create partitions. You can provide the fault tolerance by creating replica. And you can consider it as a storage system by providing retention period. If you know these three keywords, you can do pretty well in Kafka, right? So your topic, you partition it to scale it, right? And you provide the replica to make it fault tolerant. And then you provide the retention period properly to provide the storage. Now the challenge comes, depending on the data rate comes in, how fast you process, it's going to increase your pain points. So if your data rate at which it comes is not the rate at which somebody is taking it off, right, it actually creates all the problems. So that is why it's an extremely highly configurable system. You know the, you know, configuration aspects and stuff pretty well. Kafka would be the best messaging system you can deal with. And that is why New York Times, I believe, storing the newspaper since 1860 in Kafka. Okay, it's trillions of, you know, events per day. You know, LinkedIn dealing with Kafka. Netflix stores, I think, petabytes of data in Kafka. So all this because it's an extremely highly scalable, and the retentions are actually supported by the underlying disk. So it makes it much more reliable. Okay, but it's not really suited for extreme low latency real-time system, but it can be tweaked to actually make it happen. But there are so many cons as well. There are so many pros, right? But at the same time, there are so many cons as well. But we can survive with it. Okay, there are so many other alternatives. Cool, so what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna hand it over to my, you know, partner Suraj here. He will walk you through in detail the Nautilus. Cool, any questions meanwhile? All good? Thank you guys.
Thank you, Mahesh. So we'll talk about our platform. Before we talk about the platform, hello. Yeah, so we'll talk about Kafka. So Near, in the previous company, I mean, in the previous incarnation as at Near, had a connection with Kafka since 2013. So we have put, so right now, This is currently what we do. We started with Kafka 0.72, and right now I think we have different clusters with Kafka with versions up to 2.3. The Kafka ingestion rate is at about 130K overall at 3 data centers with the max at 100K QPS in a single DC. And we store about 15 TB of data every day. Our average payload is about 3 to 5 KB per message. So basically, this is just a bird's eye view of our deployment structure. So we have our applications, which is basically our APIs, deployed at 3 different data centers. And you might ask why there is a data ingestion API in front of Kafka. The reason for that is that our APIs used to be in PHP long back. So in 0.072 Kafka, it was easy to connect from PHP. But from 0.8 Kafka, it needed a zookeeper connection, which we couldn't do with PHP. That is why we wanted to decouple the Kafka client from our app. And that is why we brought in a data ingestion API. It's a HTTP API, which actually forwards the request into Kafka. So from this, we have 3 consumers for Kafka. One is an Apache Niffy, and we have 2 Apache Flink jobs, which actually read data. So we have this data in different topics. And for some, the ingestion rate is really high. For the others, it's comparatively less. So this is our Nautilus platform. We have all the Kafka topics from different data centers. We have a Niffy plus 2 Flink jobs, which actually pushes the data into DL. Right now, it's on AWS S3. Previously, it was on our on-prem hardware. From there, it goes to the data quality, data analytics platform, we clean the data here, and then we push it to the data warehouse, from where it goes to further processing into our systems. We also have a central schema server, which actually stores the metadata, and if at all there is a change, that is picked up by the central schema. So like I said, we have multiple Kafka installations for different versions. So there are certain things which are really old, like the 0.10 version, but we haven't been able to upgrade that as of now. Our biggest node is about 14 clusters. 14 has 14 machines, and it handles about 100K QPS. We partitioned the biggest topic with 64 based on some metric that we had, and it is able to handle at 120K. One of the thing is that a delay is accepted in this topic, so it's fine. What are the challenges that we faced with Kafka? It's pretty easy to upgrade. But downscaling is tough because we have to remove the nodes. Another challenge which we face with this 0.1 Kafka is that some of the partitions leader of the partitions go into a single machine, which might not have enough disk capacity to handle that. So what happens is we get a disk outage for that node, for which we have to change. Since we have a replica of one which is not manufactured, so it's like the system is all good. So other than that, we have evaluated AWS Kafka. We found it costly for our set of data, but seems to be extremely stable. So yeah, this is what we have about our Kafka. We'll wind it up. I have already crossed my time. Yeah.
So guys, as we have a few more minutes, we can make this as an interactive one. Suraj, just stand up, please. So basically, if you are aware of this word DL, for those who are not actually aware of it. So basically, what we have done is like our Nautilus platform, we split it into 3 aspects, right? So we have the raw data, the source of truth, comes and store it in data lake, which require complete exceptions, approval for processing against it. Because this is a source of truth, not good enough at times. So it doesn't make any sense to go and do heavy processing against it. So the only one person actually over here on this floor which got the permission to go against this and process the data is our DP3 head, data pre-processing platform head, right? So he will actually read off the data lake and put it into the data warehouse. Data warehouse, when it reaches, it actually covers multiple aspects. So you had the source of truth. How many of you are aware of the word canonicalization? Okay, so what happens is, when you have disparate systems, right, all these various systems, push the data under this source of truth, which is a data lake. It's coming from all different aspects with all different kind of formats and all different kind of, you know, naming conventions and whatnot, right? So let's take a simple example which we deal with, which is called as IFA ID, the device ID. Cool? And what if the same IFA ID was actually named as something different across the different sources? What would be the kind of data which you will have under the system, right? So let's say PAN number is one thing which we don't deal with, any PI information. I'm just taking it as an example, right? XYZ is a, you know, field name. And somebody else called us XYZ number. Somebody will call us XYZ NUMBER. All the stuff will be right here. You as a developer, do you want to process that kind of a data in a consistent manner? Do you? No, you know? Because then all of you will be writing all kinds of filterings and cleaning up and whatnot. That will make it a horrible experience. So what do? We actually apply all kind of filtering and the cleaning and whatnot to make the data extreme hygiene the moment it reaches the data warehouse. Okay. So for us, what has happened was like 5 months back, if you came here, it would have been, we are completely into another you know, on-premise platform where it was completely underneath was HDFS system, right? And all the 18 node, you know, data, you know, clusters were there under the HDFS, putting all this one single source of truth, right? There was no data lake aspects or the data warehouse aspect. And now what comes? So now you have here completely cleaned up, full canonicalized. Everybody talks same language. When somebody says IFA ID, everybody knows it's IFA ID across near, across our customers. For example, our product called AllSpark, we have an AllSpark ID uniquely identifying that ID is in there, right? Everybody knows AllSpark, ASPK ID means ASPK ID. So this data warehouse provides our developers that ability completely cleaned up fashion. So what is the biggest benefit of you doing this with canonicalized cleanup and filtering? Because these guys are, AWS guys are pretty expensive, right? I mean, any cloud platform is pretty expensive. So if you don't actually be careful about what you're doing with the cloud, your billing actually will shoot up. Okay, the same way I take care of my wife, I have to take care of the AWS bill as well, honestly speaking. Because before you close your eyes, I mean, and open it, your bill could be shooting up. That happens if you're not controlling what happens at this level. So how much hygiene it is, how much, you know, cleaned up it is, how much structured it is, with the central metadata and the schema supporting it, provides you the biggest underlying platform for taking it further. Now when you take it further, data warehouse is again a big source of truth. The next level, it just cleaned up, that's all, right? Now comes your different pain points you're actually going after for solving it. For who? Your customers. That comes, there comes a need for a data mart, which means we are going to provide you the smallest source of data which is really required for your use case to solve so that you're going to keep my AWS bill small. Does that make sense? Because if you're, the more the data you read, the more data you process, the more time it's going to consume, the more processing you're going to consume, the more I/O you're going to consume, the more memory you're going to consume, and I'll end up paying more. Right? So we are going to, you know, create different data marts for solving different problems. If you had to solve the gender of IOB, you know, distinction or stay point algorithms or you name it, brand affinities or whatever, the different use cases we are going after, we create the different data marts. Okay? So that is our entire Nautilus platform. The best way we can actually create the Nautilus, I mean the data marts, the cleanest way possible defines our success for the Nautilus, nothing else. Okay, so the various sources of data keep getting into here. Niffy, we actually, Apache Niffy, we introduced 8-10 months back. It's working for us so far. But we are keep looking at everything which we introduced into our system is driven by the need, not driven by the love for that particular technology. Okay, so yes. Yes, all of them are in S3. Okay, good one. So basically, the scale at which we operate, as he said, right? If you really look at how much data we are getting in per day, is 10 to 15 terabytes of data. Every day it's coming in. But then we are not actually dealing with the entire set of 10 to 12 terabytes of data for all our use cases on a day-to-day basis as well. It's depending on what exactly the problem you're trying to solve for the user. With that said, we have an analytics team which actually creates a lot of stories for our customers. For that, they have a special allowance to go against a data warehouse, not for all the other developers. Because they need the data for maybe 6 months, we retain up to 1 year, right? So they can, I mean, but they haven't seen the stories which is lasting more than 6 months. Okay, so they have to actually go against the data warehouse, process that 10 to 12 terabytes of data per day, multiplied by whatever the number. Where we are actually start noticing that, we can actually, you know, get a better output via Athena, for example, you know, faster processing, right, or better querying with underlying support it provides. Or Redshift, we have, you know, Vibor actually, you know, is it Vibor? Ishan is using the Redshift right now. So you can actually spend time with him, you know, just to see if you're curious about how is our experiment with Redshift going. So far, we have seen good results, right? For some of our use case called footfall analytics and campaign analytics, we are strongly looking at Redshift for that, so that we don't have to reinvent the wheel for the underlying query, right? Does that even answer? Okay. This one? Oh, this one? So what happens is like, see, we have a few data sources at the moment from various different sources, you know, data comes in. Now tomorrow, our data partnership guy, you know, who is heading that, will actually come and say, I'm finding better XYZ data source, which can actually give us better value for our customers, you know, for all the data which we are looking at. That will go through an evaluation process before it gets into the data lake. That means we will evaluate against what are the criteria which we looking for a particular data source to be start feeding into our system. Does it have all the fields which we are looking for? You know, what's the kind of unique number of IFA IDs which we are looking, right, versus compared to our previous data source which we already have in our system, how many uniques it's creating, because we are going to pay the money, right? So even if you have a 30% overlap, 40% overlap, the business have, management have to make a call, does the 30% extra uniqueness it is bringing for X amount of dollars, does it make sense for us to ingest, right? So that goes through our evaluation process, right? And then we generate a report after that, you know, evaluation of, you know, what are the different things this particular data source provides, and then take it from there. You want to add anything? Okay. Does that answer? Anything else? Any? Yes. Yeah, so basically, Ram, oh, yeah, sorry. The previous question was actually, you know, about the evaluation process. How do we do the data evaluation in our stage? And then the current question is, how do we do the DP3, the data pre-processing platform? It's a Python-based. We have Ram here, right here, Samaria. He actually is our Python expert. He actually did all the pre-processing, you know. So he reads it off the data lake, you know, apply all the cleansing. And there is an integration with the central metadata. Ishan, are we still using the same metadata platform? What was the name of it? Just remind me. Hortonworks? schema registering. I forgot. HSR. Yeah. Okay. So we register all the. So what happens is, like, during the evaluation process, we look at all the fields and stuff, right? And what countries it can support and blah blah blah. And we actually register them in the metadata, the initial facts, and then we actually register the all the schema aspect into the central schema. That's HSR. Metadata is nothing but in Confluence or somewhere we log it so that you know, we have all the aspects covered. So it's pure Python-based you know, pre-processing. So yeah, any other question? How do we detect the schema changes at the source levels or? You want to cover? Ram, are there any aspects whereby, you know, during your pre-processing, you know, you come across schema changes, you know, because I haven't really captured that question in my mind, because when you come to Data Lake, you have the schema which we registered over here, right, with a specific one. And the same source of data, the data source partner is going to continuously send without any change in the contract. Because if they break the contract, you know, we are not going to understand whatever they are going to send us. Well, it's all part of the contract when we sign. They have to send XYZ fields, right, at this scale every day. Do you get that? Because it's not like our REST APIs or the visual APIs where, you know, people can change the contract. But even if you change the contract over there, you announce to the consumers pretty well in advance that this is a contract and we are going to change from V1 to V2, right? And these are the new fields introduced, and that is why I'm going to change the version to V2, right? So, but we haven't come across anything specifically like that, right? Okay. Did that give you a glimpse of what we are dealing with? Okay. Let me actually give it to Ram. Ram, come over here. Just cover a little bit of your DP3 experience, right?
So whenever the data goes to the data lake, we store that in a sequence format. So all the file formats we follow are sequence across the board. And whenever we write it to the data warehouse or MARTs, actually we follow the Parquet format, so which is a columnar storage where it is easy to access the data. So across the board, actually, we follow the Parquet format. Snappy Parquet compression. Yeah. What was the format? Data lake, it's a sequence format. Sequence file. Yeah. Compression snappy. Snappy Parquet format. Yeah. Okay.
Do we enforce any Kafka messaging?
Same question? Okay. Do we enforce any schema in Kafka topic?
So yeah, the question is, do we enforce any schema in the Kafka messages that we, messages that we send to Kafka? So already the data that we get is already in a protocol called as OpenRTB. So the schema is actually set by the data partner who send us the data. We would check for validations, but it's not, you know, on the fly. It would be like a periodic, a daily or a weekly job, which actually checks for the schema and tells us that all these errors were there in the request that we get. Can you repeat the question so that I can? Yeah. So the data which goes to Kafka is not compressed, first of all. And when we read, so our schema registry, we use the HSR, which is called Hortonworks Schema Registry. It actually maps with the raw fields with the data warehouse. So raw fields, like different partners send us data in different ways. Like it could be an ID can be set by like ID1 or ID2 or like different kind of names that will come in the request. But what our schema registry would do is it would map those raw fields with the actual fields in the warehouse. Whatever fields that we have in the warehouse are canonicalized. So that is the point in our schema registry. We'll share. We'll share it in the meetup group. Yes.
So this data
sources, it is transactional data or event data? It's event data. So the question is that whether it's transactional data or event data, it's actually event data.
So it's append-only?
Yes. It's append-only, immutable.
Yeah.
Pardon? I didn't get you, sorry.
Rate arriving events.
Delayed, no. So it's all real time. We'll not be accept. The data that we get is all real time data. It happens whenever you use an app. So it's like, if at all it comes late, it's of no use.
So I just want to say thank you, guys. Really awesome, good set of questions. Thank you, Suresh. Thank you, Ram. So we have a 10 minutes break before the next session, which is actually going to be Kafka Stream Processing Fundamentals and Introduction to KeySQL DB by Confluent team. And we have Vish Srinivasan here. Yes, awesome. Thank you so much, guys, again.